So when are we supposed to start? Please start the session. Okay. Selamat siang. Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to address the audience, and it's a pleasure to do this together with three companions in a long journey of collaborative TB research between Radboud University Nijmegen and Universitas Padjadjaran, Bandung. We have not only worked on TB, we focused on infectious diseases, but today we'll focus specifically on TB. So my name is Reinhard van Krevel. I'm a professor of global health and infectious disease, and I've lived and worked for some time in Indonesia, and I've been collaborating for a very long time, especially in the field of tuberculosis. And so if we can see slides, Todia, I think you are sharing. Yes. So maybe the title slide just for a second. Okay, so this journey of collaborative TB research started with a project in 1998 that was the scientific program Indonesia and Netherlands on TB. Next slide. And so in Jakarta, in Baladewa, in a very busy area with lots of TB patients, we started our first TB study. And so in this clinic at that time, there were more people treated for tuberculosis than in the Netherlands as a whole. Next slide. And Bakhti Ali Shabana and I, we started there as part of a larger group led by Tom Ottenhoff in Leiden on TB. And so over the years, so this first study was the first study of many, and so smaller projects, bigger projects, and a group, let's say that we call it the Bandung TB Working Group, has been formed with three main aims. So it's internationally credible and relevant research in the field of TB with an impact on the quality of TB prevention and care in Indonesia, and with a very important goal also to increase research capacity, both at an institutional and an individual level. Next. And so this started with comparing TB patients and their neighbors in this area in Jakarta to see if we could find factors underlying the susceptibility to TB. So there was a hypothesis that certain genetic factors would account for this increased susceptibility. We had to find TB patients, and for that we needed to improve diagnostics for TB. So the second PhD that became involved was Ida Parvati. And of course, when we were diagnosing all these patients, we also had to properly treat TB patients. So the third area of interest became treatment. And this core of patient-related research with these three researchers that all have now grown into leadership positions was the start, let's say, but basically this core of patient-related research has remained the same. Next. And so if you think about the natural history of TB, someone is exposed to an infectious TB patient, and he or she may develop latent infection, and that latent infection, so 1/4 of the world population is latently infected. That latent infection may progress to active TB disease. And if you treat the TB, of course, you get a certain outcome. Some people survive, some people do not. And so there's four core questions for us as a group. So from a biological point of view, or from a mechanistic point of view, so what factors drive these steps from exposure to infection, from infection to disease, and from disease to outcome? And second, how can we improve? So what can we do about this natural course of events? So how can we prevent these people from developing TB? How can we improve their outcomes? And then as researchers, of course, how do we study this? And finally, it's not just about science, it's also about having societal impact. So how do we have an impact? Next. So if you think about factors driving these processes, this may be social determinants, poverty, for instance, crowding. But it may also be the bacterium. So some of the mycobacteria are that cause TB, they're more virulent than others. Or it may be the host immune system, or it may be comorbidity like HIV or diabetes, etc., or the health system. Next. Now, if you think how we could help patients and control TB, you can think about vaccination or improved diagnostics or better treatment or better ways to deal with drug resistance or better ways to deal with comorbidity and also to address these gaps in the cascade of care. Now, thirdly, next. So if you think how we study this, so over the last 20 years, we've used cohort studies, we've done diagnostic studies, we use lab sciences, clinical trials, public health studies, epidemiology. And finally, how do we want to have an impact? Of course, the impact, next, is by writing papers, but also by improving guidelines, educating people, disseminating our findings, engaging with policymakers and stakeholders, and really to try and improve the situation for our patients. Next. So in the field of TB, as I said, we've also worked, for instance, in HIV, but so the 12 PhD projects have been completed in this collaboration. So 12 international PhD projects in the field of TB. Started with Bhakti Ali Shibana in 2007, and more recently with a Dutch PhD earlier this year. Next. And a number of PhD projects are still on the way, let's say. So we have one Bonnie Lestadi who's focusing on the TB health systems. And then we have Raspati Kuzumaninata who focused on TB and diabetes. And then Edwin Adiancia, who is in the Netherlands working on the omics of tuberculosis meningitis, and Todia, who will speak today on the innate immunity to NTB infection. And so one of the 12, I should have mentioned, one of the 12 PhDs that were completed will also speak today. That's Dian, who is a postdoc, who is now a principal investigator at the Bandung TB Research Group, let's say. So. Today, we will have three researchers in various stages of their careers and with three different questions. So we'll start with Todia, who will introduce himself, who will focus on the question why some people are naturally protected against infection by mycobacterium tuberculosis. After that, we will have Alamanda, who is aspiring to start a master soon, but who has already been engaged with our group for a while and who's doing very well in examining barriers to management of drug-resistant TB in Indonesia. And finally, Dian, who completed her international PhD in the field of TB meningitis. She's continuing her studies and she will tell us on the questions that say, how can we improve survival of patients with TB meningitis, the most severe and deadly manifestation of TB? Over to you, Todia.
Thank you, Prof. Reinhardt. So, good morning, everyone. My name is Todia. I'm a medical doctor graduated from UNPAD. After graduation, I joined with the TB working group in Bandung as a junior researcher. And then I was able to continue my study master in Sweden. And since last year, I'm joining Prof. Reinhardt and to continue my PhD study in Radboud UMC, Netherlands. So in my project, it is about the innate protection against tuberculosis. But first things first, I will briefly introduce tuberculosis. So tuberculosis is a disease caused by Mycobacterium tuberculosis. It is a huge global problem with over 10 million people fell ill to tuberculosis, and 1 million are dying to tuberculosis. And tuberculosis, just like COVID, spreads through aerosols. So people are coughing and spread the bacteria. So the result of this transmission, of the spreading of this bacteria, there is estimated 1/4 of the global population are infected with this bacteria. But the people who harbor this bacterium are not necessarily ill. So most of the people who are infected with the mycobacterium tuberculosis are non-infectious and does not have any symptoms. Some people may progress into what we call active TB disease. These people are infectious and thus cough and they are symptomatic. And TB mostly affect the lungs, but it can also affect other organs. Now, Indonesia has a high TB burden, probably the third highest TB burden in the world, with 800 cases per year. And millions more are infected. So in our project, in my project, we focus on the TB infection, not the disease. So not the people who are ill, but the people who are infected and who are at risk of getting infected. It is because that people who are living with the TB disease patient are not everyone who are going to get infected. Some people are not infected. So this is our key question. Why are some people are protected against tuberculosis infection? But first, imagine if you are living in a household, in a small household in Bandung or in Jakarta, and you're living with a TB patient who are coughing a lot and produce these aerosols that contain this bacteria. Question for you: what proportion of people living with an infectious TB patient will not get infected? Think about this. These people are staying together with a TB patient who are inhaling every day of these aerosols. And what proportion are not getting infected? You can use the code from the Mentimeter, 4450-2626, to answer whether it's 3%, 6%, 12%, or 23%. I haven't seen any answer yet. Okay, I can just, for now, let's move on. So we studied the TB household context in Bandung, Indonesia. So we visited over 400 households of TB patient. And here in this house, the red dot represents the TB disease patient and the blue dot represent the people who are infected, and the green represent the people who are not infected. So we have this study called INFECT study, where when we visited this household, we collected clinical data, we collected blood samples, and then we found that some people are infected and some people are not infected. But because we visited the household early in the time of diagnosis of the TB patient, we revisited the household, the house 3 months later to find whether the uninfected, the not infected people has become infected or remain uninfected. And yes, some people are become infected after 3 months, but substantial number of people are remain uninfected. It's 23%. So there's even though these people are living closely with the TB patient every day. So what determines if someone become infected or not? The first obvious thing is the level of exposure. So for example, the TB patient who are coughing a lot, who have large cavities in the lung, who have many bacterium in the lung, high chance that these people, this TB patient, are very infectious to infect other people. And the closest of the contact, so the people living with the TB patient if they are spent many times, long hours with the TB patient, and they are sleeping in the same bed with the TB patient, then they have high chance of getting infected. For example, imagine if there's a young child who are nurtured with by his or her mother who is a TB patient, then there is a high chance that this child will become infected. Second, the strain virulence. So in COVID, you know that there is this Delta strain that are more infectious. The same thing happens in TB. We have this famous Beijing strains that if the patient have this Beijing strains, they can infect more people compared to other strains. And third is the host itself. So if people that are very young or smoking or have diabetes, they are more likely to become infected. And if they have history of BCG vaccination, they are less likely to become infected. So these are the established host factors that play a role in the likelihood of becoming infected. But our project, we wanted to understand what is the biological mechanism underlying this susceptibility. So for example, there's people who are living with TB patient who have many bacteria in the lung, coughing a lot, and these people who are living with TB patient are very young. They are smoking. They do not have history of BCG vaccination, and they are still not infected. Then the host immune function, and these people's immune function are very good to protect this against TB infection. And we wanted to know this unknown factors. So in the INFECT study, we collected massive amount of data. So it's from, there's a lot of data, but for now I'll just focus on one. But in short, we collected genomics data, gene expression data, and then the cell distribution data. And next, we will continue getting antibody data and inflammatory markers data. So there's a lot of data that we can analyze. But today, I will focus on one thing. We collected the blood metabolites of this patient, 199 samples, and we measured thousands of metabolites from each of the household contacts, and we call this as metabolome. So we wanted to compare the metabolic profile or the metabolomes of the people who are getting infected and the people who are remain uninfected. What are the differences? And we hope that we can find the underlying biology of what accounts for protection against infection. So on the left, we have what we call a volcano plot. So every dot represents the metabolites, one metabolite. So the dots that are on the right are higher in the household context, who remain uninfected, while the dots that are on the left are higher in the household context who become infected. And on the y-axis is the raw p-value. So we found that 23 metabolites have raw p-value of less than 0.05. So, but then the problem with this data set is that we have many variables, many metabolites, but only 200 or 199 subjects. So it's statistically challenging to analyze this data. But then it's not a single metabolite that accounts for protection. So it's not the one metabolite, but a pathway of the metabolite. So we we have this analysis where we can connect what are the metabolites that are in the metabolic pathways, and we found that some metabolic pathways are different between the uninfected and the one who are infected. And for example, here, tryptophan metabolism come up as the top metabolic pathways that are different. And this metabolic pathway are relevant because the tryptophan metabolism does indeed affect the macrophages and the T cell function. So we think that this metabolic pathway may play a role in the protection against infection, but we need to validate this finding using other data sets, such as the gene expression. For example, if we found the gene expression of the enzyme that in these metabolic pathways are also, then we think that it is true, this metabolic pathway does play a role in the protection against infection. In summary, first, just like what I told you before, TB infection is not the same as TB disease. Because when people that are living together with the TB patient, some people remain uninfected, even when highly exposed to TB. And I hope that through this presentation, I can show you that combining the field studies and lab sciences can help explain why that some people are remain uninfected even though they are highly exposed to TB. That's from my part. We can continue to Manda.
Thank you. So hello everyone, my name is Alamanda. I graduated as medical doctor and worked as a general practitioner in sub-district area in West Java for a year, and I've been working as a research assistant, and I am applying for possibly a master program in this next year. Next. So yeah, I'd like to share our study about rifampicin resistant tuberculosis, the cascade of care. So first, let's begin with, maybe many of you are not yet familiar with drug-resistant TB. There are several types of drug resistance, but two terms most covered in my presentation today is the RRTB, which is the bacteria resistant to rifampicin, and MDR, the multi-drug resistant TB, which is resistant to both rifampicin and isoniazid, the two main drugs, mainly treat TB until now. Oh, continue. Okay. Sorry, would you please next to my slide? Before? Yeah, thank you. Yeah, to diagnose, we use the molecular-based diagnostic tools that detect the bacteria presents to its genetic strain and further determine whether the bacteria are already resistant to rifampicin or not, and results can be seen in hours only duration. So the left one is expert. It's used in many countries worldwide, and the right one is true not, primarily used in India. And for treatment, currently, the guideline is changing fastly over the years, and the current recommendation using newer drug combination ranging to 5 to 7 drugs per day, and it's given in the shorter and longer duration. The shorter is up to 12 months, and the longer is between 18 to 24 months. Next. Okay, many of you already answered this. Let's see how it goes. Next. Yeah, so how big the problem is in Indonesia for drug-resistant TB. So in 2019, among 270 million people, the incidence but only 8.8 per 100,000 population. But among notified fungus and resistant TB cases, only half enrolled for treatment. And among those treated, the success treatment is only about 46%. It's a bit lower than the global percentage. And locally in West Java, in the first 6 months, 2021, there are new cases, about 600, that is notified, and about half initiating treatment. Next. Okay. So to evaluate the quality of the quality management of a disease, we can do it by doing a cascade of care that shows the gaps or losses between the steps taken in the patient's care that we give in the program. So we start from the diagnostic phase. This is our study group. That we do a cascade of care representing patients in West Java for 2 years, 5 years ago. And the graphic shows the first diagnostic phase, starting from the patients registered as a presumptive MDR-TB patients, and then coming for gene expert testing, and then coming for pre-treatment examination test, and then coming again for initiating MDR-TB treatment. And we see that is the biggest gap here, about 40% patients lost after doing the gene experts, after diagnose, and then coming again for pre-treatment test. And we see the time delay, the longest delay in this graphic is in the same steps. And the median time is 18 days. And then in the right far end of the slides, we actually do not know yet how many proportions of the patients that actually completed treatment in the cascade. And that's what our study is doing right now, to have the whole completed cascade of care with a longer duration of study period. Next. Okay, so our study is currently based in a clinic MDR-TB Hasan Sadikin General Hospital. It's a tertiary level hospital and provincial referral as well in West Java. We dig through the medical record, hard copy, and the electronic programmatic record as well from 2015 to 2018. We do retrospective cohort, including all presumptive drug-resistant TB patients, and focusing to those confirmed as rifampicin-resistant TB. Next. Okay, and this is the indicators for cascade of care that we use. The indicators reflecting the quality of care within a series of optimal management of that the program do. And the indicators, we measure the proportions in each indicator to see if there is the gap or the losses between each step. And we also measure the median time taken between the steps to see if there is delay. And the indicators starting from the presumptive patients identified in the clinic, and then there are samples collected for the gene expert, and then diagnosed as rifampicin-resistant TB, and then coming for pre-treatment baseline investigation, and then coming again for treatment initiation, and then we evaluate for the regimen confirmation, and that I would like to explain more later, and then follow up along the treatment up until treatment completion. What's below is the definition for the time delay that we use. And we analyze the time delay using the Kaplan-Meier survival analysis. Please next. Okay, so I'd like to ask the question, when does the biggest loss occur that you think? And next, how next? Okay, and actually the second question is how long is the delay that you may think revealed in our study. But yeah, let's move on to the results. So this is the first result. Slide sebelumnya kan? Please move to the previous. Yeah, thank you. So this is our first results. We identify presumptive drug-resistant TB during the full year. There are 9,600 patients, of whom 96% had samples collected and tested for gene expert, and then we identify that is 10.2% confirmed as new rifampicin resistant TB cases, and among these new cases, about half is male with median 39 years old, and then about 40% previously treated with TB. So many patients coming for testing due to relapse and treatment failure, and a portion had comorbidities, diabetes mellitus, and HIV. Next. Yeah, this is our main cascade of care results, focusing the quality of care indicators to those diagnosed as rifampicin resistant TB. So starting from the left, the first bar showing that 982 new patients confirmed through the rapid molecular test, and then going to the second indicator, it's going down a bit. There is 91% patients coming for pre-treatment test, and then 81% actually initiating second line treatment. And then going down further, there is 36 patients that who are having treatment whose regimen we can confirm for appropriateness. And then going along the treatment, so among all these new rifampicin resistant TB cases, we found that only 21% that actually completed successfully within the steps of optimal management in the cascade. And then our first main message is in the biggest loss. So we see between the third and the fourth bar that 45% of a patient starting treatment actually do not have DST. DST is a drug susceptibility testing. It's a test performed by bacterial culture to detect more of the drug resistance beyond the rifampicin, including drugs that is used to treat the patients in the current regimen. And then looking at the second and the third indicators, even though the proportions are high in terms of losses, there are major delays that we found here. About 78% patients delay for pre-treatment tests before after diagnosis with median 11 days. And then there are 79% patient delay while initiating the treatment, with median about 8 days. Next. Okay, so here are our recommendations. So the first one is only a portion of the cases that we can diagnose currently. So we recommend to improve the access to early TB case detection. And then only half of those starting the treatment whose regimen can be confirmed. So suggest to expand the molecular testing and culture-based resistance testing to identify more variants and types of drug resistance. And then there are major delays that we found occur before the treatment phase. So recommend the decentralized treatment, having more programmatic treatment centers in sub-districts in West Java, but still maintaining the quality. And then the take-home message is probably that we think that we can evaluate the quality of care by using the cascade of care. It can shows the steps in the care itself that we can measure the gaps and also the delays. And then the results that are revealed are the problems that is site or region specific. So it can be used to lead the area of intervention to be focused in the future time. Next. Thank you. So this is our study group, the collaboration from UNPAD, Hasan Sadikin Hospital, and Prof. Philip from University of Otago, and Prof. Rainer from Radboud University. I think Dr. Dian will continue the presentation. Thank you.
This is my turn. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Sofia Tidian, and I finished my medical doctor from Universitas Padjadjaran at 2001, and finished my neurology residency at 2007. I also finished PhD at Radboud University Medical Center at 2018, and now I'm working as a lecturer and also in a principal investigator in Infectious Disease Research Center. Next. So just Todia described earlier about the tuberculosis. Tuberculosis meningitis is the most severe form of TB. And when it spread to other organs from the lung, it usually stay as rich focus, and then later on it will burst and causing inflammation in a human brain. And that's the time when it causing tuberculosis meningitis. Next. So we really noticed that this disease is very devastated, and we have been today Radboud University and Universitas Padjadjaran have been doing an excellent collaboration in improving the survival of TB meningitis patients. Several projects have been done to answer some questions, including improving diagnosis, treatment, and finding mortality risk factors. So since 2009, we have had at least 4 PhDs from Radboud University Medical Center working on TB meningitis research. Next. Now I have one question. So among people with central nervous system infection, what is the proportion of people getting TB meningitis? Is it 1 to 2%, or 25 to 30%, or even more, 50 to 60%? Let's answer these questions next. So first of all, I will show you the map of West Java. This is the most populous province in Indonesia. We have almost 50 million residents in this province. And Indonesia itself is the fourth most populous country in the world, with the HIV prevalence in the general population is low, but Indonesia has the second fastest growing HIV epidemic in Asia. Our hospital is the top referral hospital for West Java. As increasing of HIV infected cases, the number of central nervous system infection cases is also growing. TB is only one among so many etiology of this infection. Yet the mortality and also the morbidity caused by this disease are as high as brain tuberculosis. However, we haven't known about this disease yet. To better understand these patients, we have to understand more about the etiology, diagnosis, risk factors, and also the treatment of this disease. Next. So here we are trying to answer those questions by conducting study called IBIS, Indonesian Brain Infection Study, to define the clinical presentation, etiology, management, and also the outcome of patients with central nervous system infection in Indonesia. Next. So this cohort study participated one big hospital in Jakarta, Cipto Mangunkusumo Hospital, and two hospitals in Bandung, Hasan Sadikin and also Emmanuel Hospital. We screen suspected central nervous system infection patients and perform clinical, laboratory, and also radiology evaluation, as well as 12 months of follow-up to see the survival of those patients. Next. We also conducted microbiological testing, including retrospective testing on archive sample for viral encephalitis and also for autoimmune disease. Next. So this is the result. After the exclusion of 50 patients with alternative diagnosis, we included 449 patients, 14 patients were tested for HIV, and around a quarter of them were HIV positive. Lumbar puncture was done in 340 patients, and if no lumbar puncture, mainly because there's a risk of brain herniation in those patients. Our follow-up was almost complete until 1 year. Next. As you can see, and this is also the answer for the first questions, the most prominent central nervous system infection was caused by tuberculosis, as many as 59%, followed by viral encephalitis. And we also found a small number of fungi infection and also autoimmune meningitis. Next. And in this chart, we can see that the baseline characteristic of our patient comparing those with and without HIV, we can see that our patients mainly presented after 2 weeks of neurological symptoms with very severe disease. Almost 2/3 were unconscious and many reported seizures and also hemiparesis or motor abnormalities. Next, after 6 months of, our initial diagnosis sometimes shifting as we get new data from new examination during hospitalization, and it's about 26%. But as I said before, our main cause of CNS infection is tuberculosis. Next. And regarding the outcomes of EBIS or all CNS infection patients, our 6 month mortality is around 52%. Especially in TB meningitis patients, our 6 month mortality is almost 54%. Also in the 12 month mortality is also only at 1%. So it's around 54%. Next. Okay, we are going to the second question. What factors are associated with higher mortality of TB meningitis patients? Is it HIV? Is it low of consciousness? Or is it delay of treatment or delay of diagnosis? Okay, to answer this question, let's see our next slide, please. In this framework, we can see that CNS infection, in particular tuberculosis meningitis, is a very complex disease. So many factors may contribute to its low survival rate. First, we can see that poor patients' perception of their illness and behavior may also influence the decision taken by patients to go to the hospital earlier. And we can also see that the lack of our understanding of the immunopathology of this disease may cause us to only have limited approach to improve the patient's outcome. And three, regarding the regimen for treating TB meningitis, we still in doubt whether our antibiotic that we give to the patients is sufficient or not. And the last one regarding the risk factor for mortality, probably we have to find out more risk factor to improve our outcome, the outcome of the patients. That's why we have several agendas for now. Next slide. And this is the agendas of our group. So now we have a cohort study, included three big hospitals in Jakarta and also in Bandung. And we are going also to answer the question regarding the underlying biological mechanism. To examine the cerebrospinal fluid inflammatory markers, as well as host and mycobacterium tuberculosis genetics, and also the metabolomics from the cerebrospinal fluid. And this is assumed by our new project called Ultimate. We also have dexamethasone for cerebral toxoplasmosis, linezolid for TB meningitis patients, and also intensified dose of rifampicin for TB meningitis patients. And three of this study is the clinical trials conducted in Bandung and also in Jakarta and other countries. And the last one, we also want to answer the question regarding the patient's lay hospital. And we have the last project called Papaya Project, and this is about TB meningitis patient pathway. Next slide. Next. So this is us, keep growing and help each other to answer so many questions to improve the survival of TB meningitis patients. Thank you, and I give it back to Prof. Reinhold. Please, Reinhold.
Thank you, Diane. So three nice stories, three difficult questions, three nice stories. And so you see here, the first one, Tadia, was focused on lab science. The second one from Amanda was more public health. And Diane just took us through maybe a combination of clinical and public health, let's say, research. Next. So maybe before I address this, so these are examples of our academic collaboration. Maybe there is one question that we saw in the chat from Ika Nulaila, who asks if there is an approach applied to the clinical realm to cure TB, and what is our insight about resistance of patients towards drugs given so far? That's a difficult question, Ika, there's not a single solution. Obviously, it's a combination of things. If we get a more effective vaccine, if we change something about the social determinants of disease, if we understand the biology and improve our host immune system, if we improve our health system and improve the cascade of care, if we improve the things that Diane has addressed, so if we improve antibiotic treatment, but maybe also early diagnosis, etc. So there's a lot of things that are relevant for improving outcome of patients and curing patients. About resistance, the same can be said about resistance. So there is and I think Amanda is focusing on something that is critical in this situation, and that is just where do we lose our patients that may continue to spread drug-resistant TB? So how can we improve the cascade of care and make sure that people are retained to care, that they start treatment and that they start appropriate treatment, etc. That's one critical thing. Of course, another critical thing is the lab. So how can we make a solid and quick diagnosis of drug-resistant TB? And finally, how can we improve the second line drug treatment? So this is a big topic, not just for Indonesia, but worldwide. I hope I have answered your question there. So if we can see the slide again. So what I hope that these three researchers and their three stories show is our comprehensive approach. So we can combine molecular laboratory science with patient studies and with population research and with public health studies. This is also different disciplines are involved and not just purely biomedical or medical. Another important thing of the collaboration, I think, is the talent management. So you see the journey that Todia and Amanda and Jan go through. It takes a lot of time to become an internationally credible researcher, and nurturing, talent in this collaboration is very important. And then, of course, interacting with other relevant stakeholders and interacting with international collaborators. Now it's focused on Nijmegen, but we're not alone in this collaboration with the Bandung TB Research Group, as said. And finally, last but not least, strong local leadership, people that keep the group together and who have a good vision are crucial for making this a success. Maybe one of my co-speakers will want to add to this. Jan, you've been with the group for a long time. Maybe there's something that you'd like to share regarding your experience or what.
Thank you, Reinhard. Yeah, I think we have still have a lot of questions to answer, and there's opportunity for us to work together to answer these questions. And we have tried to improve the management and diagnosis and treatment and so on, but still the mortality is very high. So maybe we have to do something more. I think that's all from me right now.
Good. Todia?
What I wanted to point out is that this academic collaboration is can be copied by anyone. For example, in my case, in 2016, I was just a freshly graduated doctor, and I joined the research study of infect. So I come to the I visited the house with the nurses, and I don't know whether I'm going to do PhD study or not. But then, through this talent management, now I can continue on to PhD in the same infect study. I don't know why, but then it's maybe we other people in Indonesia, in other institution can copy this talent management, nurture the talent, I guess. Yeah.
Good. Thank you. Alamanda.
Yeah, Pak. I think based on our study in drug-resistant TB up until now, and based on what I've observed in this 3 years, there are a lot of problems that require the collaboration and integration between different fields like the public health practitioner and then microbiologists, and as well as the clinicians. So if we can make this academic collaboration stronger and more integrated to study more about drug resistance, I think it will help to increase the treatment success.
Well, it's nice to hear that you all have a strong desire and a strong drive to continue and to answer all these very difficult questions. These are very difficult problems, and unless we work on it with focus and with team science as a group of researchers, we won't find the solutions. Okay, I think we've reached the end of the session. I'm not sure if there's any other questions from the audience. If not, then I'd like to thank everyone for listening, and like to thank my companions for giving their great talks about their respective projects. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Prof. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, Prof, for the opportunity. Bye-bye.